Hello, everyone. I have the extraordinary honor today to host Chris Peterson, the candidate for governor for the Democratic Party, as our special guest today. He's one of several, but Chris is the leading candidate, according to the polls. So stick around. You don't want to miss this. Chris, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you, Devin. It's such an honor to be here. I'm just delighted. And what a great idea. It's so hard to make connections to people. The thing I was looking about most about running for office is the chance to just get out and shake hands and, like, I get out of my office and talk to people and help, you know, build community and build enthusiasm for you know, the Democratic Party. And then, you know, of course, the crisis hits and we're all stuck in our houses. And so, yeah. Devin, you've really been a leader on this by helping people make some connections using technology. So thank
you
so much.
It has been wonderful. It's been a joy and really a privilege to get to know so many great people, many of whom are running for office. Others are community crusaders who are just making the world so much better. And it's been a ball. But Chris, what do you want to talk about?
Well, I think the topic of the day needs to be this terrible pandemic, the economic fallout. I think it's just what's on people's mind. What's on my mind. I'm obviously campaigning is a big thing for me right now. But in order to try to convince the public that I'm deserve the chance to be the governor, I've got to stay on top of this. And I know that so many people across the country and here in Utah are really troubled by what they're seeing, both in terms of public health, but also in terms of the economic fallout. I also worry a lot about the next phase of things. When, you know, even if we manage to start to reopen and get people back to work, what happens to the people who are behind on their bills, their home mortgage payment, their lease on their home, their car payments? So many challenges that we're going to have to sort through right now. So that's what I want to talk about. What do you think?
Yeah. These are all great issues, Chris. You know, in Utah, we have been really fortunate, and I really credit the people of Utah with doing a good job at sheltering in place in the absence of an order from the governor. Now, some of the municipalities, counties have done that, but we've done a good job. The virus isn't spreading too wildly. But how do you think about the next phase as we start talking about reopening businesses and things? How do you think about how we should proceed?
Well, huge problems here. I mean, I see two basic problems. The first is that this virus is a very dangerous infectious disease. The things I'm reading from some public health officials are, we don't know for sure what the mortality rate is, but it is much higher than the flu. It's also more infectious because people carry it and don't know that they're spreading the disease. Some people are asymptomatic, or they just spread before their symptoms appear. And so it can grow at an exponential rate. So even if there are only a handful of people out in the community, they're still spreading and are unaware, we may have very low numbers of deaths or hospitalizations or new tested diseases right now, but give it another week and then another week and then another week, and it could start to grow exponentially just like it has in so many other places around the world. So that's problem number one. We've had slow trajectory because we've been social distancing, keeping that down. But what happens if we flip the switch back and everybody goes back to work? Well, the disease is still out there. We don't have any treatments that are successful. We don't have any immunity, and a vaccine is still on the distant horizon. So we risk just having the exponential growth curve start all over again. On the other hand, people's savings are being exhausted. Businesses are collapsing all across the state. And for some people, it's going to get grim and very difficult hard. Not only are people being furloughed and losing their jobs, their business is collapsing. At some point, many of these people are going to start to get hungry. I mean, let that sink in. That's not something that we have really seen on a broad scale in America for a long time. And once that happens, people will start to get desperate. So we at the same time, we need to protect ourselves, but we need to make sure that people can get work and have an economy that functions in a way that allows them to get by. So it seems to me, and this is the answer to your question, in a roundabout way, we've got to start to come up with a plan that if we are going to open up again, it has to be an aggressive plan to keep people safe. And I think, you know, I've been putting together a to-do list that the government, I believe, needs to take in partnership with the private sector. And there are a lot of to-do items on this. I hope that we're getting to the point where we're ready to do it responsibly. I have some concerns about whether or not we have the resources, the supplies, the focus, and are ready to make the sacrifices, both in the public sector and in the private sector, that's necessary to keep people safe while we start up our economy again.
Yeah, it's difficult even to get face masks, not N95 face masks, just an ordinary face mask. And, you know, there are 1,000 YouTube videos telling us how to improvise one, but they really aren't great improvised face masks. So there's a lot to do. Well, Chris, I really appreciate you taking the time to be with us today. I wish we could talk about this for an hour, and maybe we should have a special episode where you and I get together and talk about it for an hour. But thank you for making the time today. Before you go, will you tell everyone, what is your superpower?
My superpower? Oh, I don't know that I have a superpower, but what I do care a lot about is the well-being of ordinary working families across our state. I want to fight to try to take care of folks and make sure that we have a more balanced government that works for everyone, not just special interests, not just the lobbyists that are behind the scenes pulling the strings. We need to make sure that our small businesses, our families, our communities are being taken care of. And I'm going to fight to do that. Thanks, Devin.
Fantastic. Chris, one last thing before you go. Tell people where they can learn more about your campaign.
Yeah, sure. Please come by petersonforutah.com, my campaign website. You can also follow us on Facebook or Twitter.
Fantastic. Well, Chris, thank you very much for being with us today. We wish you every success in helping to develop that to-do list that we can implement to make our transition back to work safer and more successful.
All right. Thanks, Devin. You take care of yourself. Stay safe.
All righty. Let's do some good.
I'm Devin Thorpe. For the last 8 years, I've been working full-time to eradicate extreme poverty, improve global health, and fight climate change. I've concluded that the best way for me to continue my work is to run for Congress to represent the people of Utah's 3rd District. In Utah, we have common shared values. Those things unite us. I believe passionately in our ability to come together, and I believe that working together, we can solve Utah's problems. I'm Devin Thorpe. I'm a Democrat. I'm running to represent the people of Utah's 3rd District.
I'm Devin Thorpe, a candidate for Congress, and I approve this message.